Hey, how's it going, guys? I'm Paradoxic, and we are back with yet another reaction for Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. More reactions for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I'm on a bit of a Marvel high this week, as last weekend I saw Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings for the first time. My movie review is out, so feel free to go check that out. But I watched Shang-Chi. I loved it would be an understatement. So yeah, to say that I loved it would be quite the understatement. It's a phenomenal movie. If you haven't had the chance to check it out yet, absolutely go check it out. First big screen Asian superhero for Marvel, but as we know, we got technically our first Asian superhero in this one. We have Quake, our first Asian American superhero, so that is also cool. But on the big screen, you know, Simu Liu, Shang-Chi, just, you know, like, the movie rocks, he rocks, everyone involved rocks. So I've just kind of been, like, mulling that entire movie from start to finish over in my head. I'm dying for a second viewing, but I'm not that sure about, like, an actual theater viewing, or if I should actually wait for the 45-day release for on Disney Plus, because then that way my second viewing could also be like an additional reaction to the channel. So I'm kind of mulling that over too. But I've literally just been kind of like thriving and living off of the hype of that movie and just being like, oh god, it was so good, I love it so much, and I need to update my Funko Pop collection again and actually get the 3 pops in the movie. But I've just been just thriving off of that hype. It's just a really great movie, and I love it so much. It's just so powerful and impactful and just action packed and hilarious, and it's so good. This is not me kind of promoting Shang-Chi in a sponsored way. I am in no way sponsored by Marvel or Disney in any way. It's just me literally kind of gushing my love for it. But yeah, like I said, this week for me has just been a Marvel high, so I figured, you know what, I actually did manage to skip a week with last week's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. reaction, so we are coming back into the show with full force and everything. So yeah, back in, we gotta see my girl Daisy Johnson become Quake again. Gotta see her become Quake again in the framework. Seeing her unleash those powers is nothing but a heaven sent sight to behold. So that would be cool. But yeah, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode 18 we had last time, and yeah, we said hello to Trip. We got Antoine Triplett back. We got our dear Antoine Triplett, our boy Triplett, who was taken from us so savagely in season 2. And I think I actually saw like an actual comment about this floating around somewhere on the internet after I watched that episode, and it was that, you know, like the first time, a neat little kind of parallel between kind of Trip's appearances in the show is that, you know, like the first time Daisy goes through Terra Genesis, she unintentionally ends up he ends up dying during that kind of process, but then the second time she goes through Terra Genesis, he's alive and well, and he's back with S.H.I.E.L.D., and he's working for the Resistance, and he's actually helping to take down Hydra again. So, yeah, so the second time she goes through Terra Genesis, we actually get him back safe and sound, and then this time he can live to see, she can meet him, she can actually find him again, and then, you know, and he can see her in all of her quaking kind of beauty and glory and everything. So since I read that comment, I have actually been anxious and eager to get back into this, to see exactly how that kind of interaction unfolds and to see what it has in store for us. And I think to actually see like a further continued kind of friendship between Daisy and Trip, although I mean he would know her Sky, like he would definitely still know her as Sky, but we said hello to Trip. But then as one agent returns from the ashes, we had to unfortunately say goodbye to another one who in the framework was the director of S.H.I.E.L.D. We had to say goodbye to Mr. Jeffrey Mace. Jeffrey in the framework, he was a real inhuman, he was an inhuman, and he was the inhuman director of S.H.I.E.L.D., the leader of the Resistance, and he was the Patriot again, and he was he was the actual superhero he actually wanted to be when he was out in the real world without any kind of actual government interference or fake serums or anything like that. So he was an actual hero, and he died saving kids. He died saving kids from like a fallen building that Hydra had launched rockets at and everything. So he died being crushed under rubble and everything. So, and as we know, the rules of the framework, you know, if you're an actual kind of insert into the framework, if you're a person from the real world insert into the framework, then, you know, if you die in the framework, you die in real life too. So they did do a lovely kind of heart-wrenching confirmation cutting back to the real world of Mace's kind of heart monitor just flatlining and showing that he, you know, he's gone now, and then Ada disengaged him, so Mace is gone. The Patriot has gone. So RIP to him. He was a fantastic character. I think, like, in and out of the framework, I loved him as a character. He was such a good... He was a genuinely good guy who tried to do the right thing and kind of got caught in the middle of a lot of bad stuff from time to time. So he, you know, he was the hero that always tried. He was the hero that always tried. And then in the framework, he actually finally got to be the hero he wanted to be, and he gave his life for a cause and for a purpose and a reason that he believed in. So he died... like in a way that he actually could have been, that he actually could have been proud of, saving people and saving kids, especially from Hydra's grasp too. So he went out in one of the bravest ways possible. So yeah, but now S.H.I.E.L.D. is without a leader. S.H.I.E.L.D. is without a director. I mean, I don't know. I really don't know if they actually established like a second in command, or if maybe now, or if maybe now the team now, because I think the team is mostly assembled. Mostly, I think minus Fitz. Fitz is the only one. Fitz is the only, because I think he's so deep and high in Hydra. Soap and everything. He's the only one left, but we have Simmons there, we have Daisy there, and I think May is all. May had her own revelation. May had her own revelation after finding out that, you know, kids were being kept from the quarantine zone and Hydra was experimenting on them and actually putting them through all this kind of stuff, and she was actually, you know, like, shocked to see kids there and everything. So then, and to even see, like, Mace actually kind of like helping to, and to see that Hydra had actually then ordered that kind of kill order on kids who were in the quarantine. I think kids who also were not actually. I think those kids weren't necessarily actually confirmed or denied to being human, but I think it was just like kids under suspicion, kids under suspect of being human. So kids who were just kind of suspect to Hydra regardless. But then actually seeing that kind of environment and everything kind of got her shocked and kind of really taken aback, and seeing Mace kind of literally putting his life on the line and even giving his life to save those kids actually kind of changed her perspective on things too. So then she comes back in swinging. She comes back in swinging with the ultimate sledgehammer, which is a hammer in the form of a Terrigen crystal. So she goes into Daisy's interrogation room and smashes the crystal on the floor and allows Terrigenesis to begin once again. So Quake is coming. Quake is a coming. She's a coming. So now I think May is now like this is officially May actually kind of actually handing in her resignation to Hydra in the most badass way possible, and then her and Daisy are gonna end up actually fighting their way out like mother like daughter, out of Hydra and back into S.H.I.E.L.D.'s hands and everything. So yeah, so I think, yeah, like, most of the team have reassembled now. So we got Daisy, we got Gemma, we got May, we got Coulson, we got Mac, and Trip is there now too, and then we got actual good guy Ward too, so more hands than we had before, and now they're all going to try and take down Hydra. And also, taking down Hydra, I don't know if that's going to be like their main objective, but then I think actually taking down Hydra perhaps, but then, because like the Hydra in this world isn't real, because the framework itself is like an alternate kind of AR, like an alternate virtual reality. So then I think actually getting out of the framework and then destroying the framework once they're on the outside, I think that would be the main priority. But then I think if destroying Hydra on the inside is the only way to the outside, then I think they might just consider that too. So yeah, but damn, this is shaping up to be one hell of a third act for the entire season. Like, this season just comes in like three different acts, so this is shaping up to be one hell of a third act. So yeah, and then we also met Fitz's father too. Fitz's father, the abusive father that walked down him and his mother in the real world. In the framework, he stuck around, and I think, I don't know what that means, like, for the mother, if she stuck around too, or maybe if Fitz, or maybe if Fitz's father still left, but then he took Fitz with him as well. Maybe he actually took him away from his mother, so then he ended up just going up under his dad, and he grew up to be the second-hand leader of this kind of Nazi, like a present-day Nazi cult. So then we know that, you know, they took the love and compassion coming from Gemma away from him, and then they put the cold-hearted ruthlessness and, you know, darkness in him from his father and maintained that, and he's still stuck around to this day too. In the present day, he's still giving him all these different kind of hate, like harmful mentalities and all these different sayings and everything. And then he's got Ophelia and Madame Hydra in his corner too, so Fitz is not in a good place. He's not in a good place right now, and he doesn't realize it yet, but, you know, he needs to take that red pill. He needs to take that red pill from the Matrix. So And yes, I am watching this straight after watching The Matrix Resurrections trailer. I did a reaction to that, so I am still, I still got the trailer somewhat fresh in my mind. So, yeah. I mean, this could also technically count as The Matrix too. Yeah. So, I mean, the framework could easily count as The Matrix too. Yeah. Like they're all plugged in. They're all plugged into The Matrix. That is actually, I think, that is also like an equally accurate analogy to make. And I think the so I think. The soap, I mean, could also be seen as like a good analogy for the pills too. Like, Hydra soap is the blue pill, continuing to live in ignorance, and then Coulson's homemade soap is the red pill. So they're like the blue soap or the red soap. So that could easily also work. And then there are very few who then manage to actually become self-aware in the actual framework itself, in the Matrix itself, and then you got machines on the outside. You got machines in the real world, Ada, and whatever the hell she did to Anton Ivanov. I think she turned him into like a cyborg or something. So they got machines on the outside. This is just the Matrix. This is the Hex and the Matrix. The Hex from WandaVision, and also the Matrix from the Matrix. So yeah, but anyway, so yeah, that is pretty much all I've got from the last season. We got some dark stuff with the actual kind of quarantine zones and the actual. The kind of containment kind of cages and all these different kind of like just like all these different kind of horrible things from like all these different sites that Hydra operates out of more brutally and more kind of oppressively. So yeah, we had that stuff too, but yeah, that is pretty much all I can recall from the last episode. So now going into episode number 19 of season 4. So yeah, onto the reaction, and as you guys will know by now, this one will just be the fair use version where you get the best bits and the highlights of the episode. But if you guys want to watch the full length version of the reaction, then that one will be over on Patreon, so you can go check that out over there too. That would be just as much fun. So yeah, Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. season 4, episode 19. Let's go.
The danger can lurk around any corner.
Let's go! Let! There we go. There we go. Ooh, yeah, there we go. Oh, that music came in. That music came in. The Quake theme. Okay, time to break out. Time to break out, yeah. Oh, yeah, two top tier S.H.I.E.L.D. spies. They are gonna wreck this place. They are gonna wreck this place. Yeah. Oh, she's got you. She's got you. Oh yeah. Can we Matrix this? Can we actually Matrix this somehow?
She Matrixed it! She did the flip.
Oh hell no.
Drop your weapon.
Oh hell no. Yes, yes, yes! Did she just kill Madame Hydra? Did she just kill Madame Hydra? No. Would that have killed? Oh god, I don't know if you can take out Madame Hydra that easily. You see, watching this episode after watching the Matrix trailer just kind of, it hits different. It hits so fucking different.
It is no more than a slight complication.
Then I will uncomplicate it for you.
No, don't you dare. Don't you dare. He can't pull the trigger.
Why can I not kill her?
Because I built you. My primary directive requires me to protect these people.
Ah, so that directive is still in place.
And we are
okay.
Both powerless.
Not entirely.
The Patriot's dead?
Yeah, no.
I know what he meant to the Resistance.
You said in the real world, too.
There is, however, cause for concern regarding her spotting.
Oh.
We're still determining the extent of the nerve damage, but there are exciting...
Leave.
Oh, it's his hands. His hands, oh.
No.
Oh, boy. His hands are like that and he's talking calmly. That is anger. That is anger at its core.
We'll find a way to help.
Oh, boy.
We're all hoping for Ophelia's recovery.
Oh,
meantime,
God. His eyes.
You're the new head of Hydra.
Oh, he's the head of Hydra. Oh, good God. Oh, no. don't think I've ever been more terrified to look into a pair of eyes.
Leopold, I came as soon as I could. What kind of...
He's on a first name basis with him, really?
This woman, known by the alias Sky, is a member of the Inhumans First movement.
Her Inhumans goal First.
Destabilize Hydra from within. We warn our audience.
Just such a good picture,
that
too.
This Inhuman has the potential.
The guy on the TV said she was dangerous.
Yeah, well, the girl on the TV
she
is a dick.
Nice. Mm.
Sweetheart, the news is controlled by Hydra.
That, too.
Just try not to pay any attention to that, okay? Everything's gonna be all right.
I could have changed my life that day.
Hmm.
But it seemed like too much responsibility. I didn't want to shoulder it. Now I think maybe I should have.
I was serving time. Arson, first degree. Pretty sure my life was over.
Same backstory.
That's when someone came to me.
John Garrett?
What was his name?
John Garrett?
She'd laugh that you assumed it was a guy.
Oh.
Her name was Victoria Hand.
Woo!
She was the first person to tell me I could be a good man.
Victoria Hand.
This guy was the one who made me believe it.
Oh.
Now she is in danger.
I love that flip over Victoria Hand. God, is she still alive today? Tell me she's still alive. I don't know. She would fell. I don't know if she'd still be alive. That is even more robbery. We deserve Victoria Hand fighting the good fight in the framework. We deserve Victoria Hand back again. Oh, hell no.
You see that look? Maybe she's just racist. Mm. Or starstruck.
Mm. Or both. No, well... Project Looking Glass.
This is quantum energy manipulation. I've seen this machinery before.
So is it meant to be the same portal, like how they brought...
It's creating something even more complex.
Yeah, like how they brought Ghost Rider and Coulson back.
I know who you are. There's chatter all over the police band.
Okay, so get them into the resistance then.
We were careful.
Oh, God. Oh, no. Oh, a grenade launcher, really? Oh, nice. Oh, there we go. That was so cool. Just quaking the grenade back into the car. That was so cool.
Hey, the spark plug. I have to take off for a little bit to help S.H.I.E.L.D.
Can I help?
Maybe when you're older. Maybe when you're older.
Maybe you can show the other kids how to fix a radio.
That might take a while, but...
Keep her occupied. Keep her occupied.
You didn't know.
Yeah, she does. She
doesn't change what I did.
You can't blame yourself for their lies. Once you learned the truth, you fought back.
Focus on what she needs, son. I'll put these traitors down for good.
Oh, God. I really look forward to seeing him die, to seeing him getting taken down a few hundred thousand notches. Oh, geez, death from above. Yes, Mama May. Death from above. Oh God, I love this.
Stop right there.
Oh, I don't love this. Oh, I love that. I love that. Mac Daddy, come in. Oh.
Hydra messed with her head, but she's fighting back now.
I didn't know she's not lying.
Oh.
Not a good time to be holding guns on our allies.
Oh, Coulson.
Report in. What's the situation down there?
We got it covered, don't worry.
Now, these wounds don't heal overnight. But for reasons I can't fully explain, I trust this woman. So should you.
Not even the framework can defeat love. This not even that can cover up love. So this can't be in the framework. This is the color grading is different. The color grading is different. That can't be in the framework.
I guess this isn't where she's building the damn thing.
No, this is where she's building it.
In the real world. In the real world.
Now I know what it will do. We have to stop her.
Hey, I'm not gonna pretend to get all this, but I'm here to help.
You believe me? About another world?
Come on, girl. That's way too crazy a story to make up.
Believing her right off the bat, that is the trip that we know. Supportive and understanding. Oh, boy. Yeah, he's moving ahead. He's moving very, very far ahead. And they've got the same holographic table thing they had. Yeah. On the bus.
They broke her spine. I want them dead!
Don't you snap at me.
Oh.
Boy.
Oh, damn.
You hysterical at every setback. I would have left you with your mother.
Yeah, he took him from his mother. He left and took Fitz with him.
I have yet to turn over every stone.
Someone knows where they're going. I'll find them.
I can't show any weakness, which means I can't tolerate failure. Even from my own father.
Oh shit, what? What does that mean? Is he gonna try and kill his dad? He can't tolerate failure from his own dad?
I'm gonna go talk to Simmons.
Well, she and Aza Triplett are on a recon mission.
Trip?
Trip, yeah, our boy Trip's back.
That's the best news I've heard in weeks.
Yeah, I love seeing them react to all this new news.
It's not exactly. I know a way for us to get back home.
By us, you don't mean me. I guess I was holding out hope that Simmons was wrong. And that you'd still be the girl I knew. I'm glad you're safe, Daisy.
Oh, he called her Daisy. No, he called her Daisy. Oh boy, great. Am I really feeling sad for Grant Ward now? Framework Grant Ward. He's a good guy, you can't help it. Oh god, fucking damn it. You know what? This is what happens when he's influenced by someone as powerful and good as Victoria Hand.
Here, you're just a snippet of code that Ada changed slightly so you'd stick around for Fitz. Alistair Fitz is so thick he doesn't recognize his own
Alistair Fitz.
Pathetic, drunk. Even here, you're nothing without him. So do what you will. I've got nothing left to give.
Oh, good God. Oh. Oh, jeez. Oh. He is going to town on him.
There's no magic bullet against Hydra.
Yeah, this footage is as close as it comes. I mean, people will finally wake up.
No, you don't understand. None of this will matter in the long run. It's... This is the only chance to actually wake people up.
Maybe the only way to solve our problem is to solve their problem.
You break down Hydra, then you get all the help you can get. Build the resistance.
Those coordinates right now is next to impossible.
Yeah.
To save ourselves, we need to save the world.
Okay. Oh boy, oh. Oh, they're breaking into the news station. They're breaking into Bakshi report. The Bakshi report.
But you were looking for some enemies of the state.
Ah, who's it gonna be? Who's gonna talk? Who's gonna speak? I think probably Coulson, right? Coulson would be the ideal representative of the S.H.I.E.L.D. Oh, has he finished it? Yeah. It's just like one giant TARDIS. It's just like a frickin' TARDIS, but it's more cylindrical.
Take me with you.
I hoped you'd say.
Oh no, they're gonna bring Dr. Fitz into the real world.
What?
Oh, she's tying his tie again.
No,
she's tying his tie again.
Done this before.
Deja vu?
Oh, Belinda Crumbs, Belinda Crumbs. Right,
you may be onto something.
I would hate for you to think that I am anything like the Grant Ward you knew over there. Simmons said he was a real son of a bitch. Guessing things didn't end well.
I don't know what to say.
It's okay.
Oh god, fucking, why are you doing this to me? I didn't ask for this. Why are you doing this to me? Why are you doing this to me?
After you're gone, do I get my sky back?
Oh no, the framework gets torn down because it's too dangerous.
Honestly, I don't know. I guess there was some good in him all along.
Yeah, it took Victoria Hand to bring it out, yeah.
And I hope that sky comes back to you.
They're really making me root for this guy. They are really making me root for Framework Grant Ward.
But Hydra was willing to kill them just to maintain their lie. Once you see this footage, the truth is undeniable.
Mm-hmm.
Hydra doesn't think we're smart enough to know when we're being fed alternative facts. To keep us afraid. To keep them in power. We all have the opportunity to be patriots.
Mm.
Will you take a stand?
Hell
are you
yes.
Going to hold them accountable?
Hell yes.
No. They're not Hydra. I think they're here to help us fight.
Oh, damn. They're building a resistance. They're building a resistance.
They realize they're a part of something bigger.
Fury. Fury, yeah.
To become a part of something bigger.
A part.
I really do believe that together we can accomplish anything. Because the truth is, I'm not just a history teacher. My name is Phil Coulson. And I'm an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Hell yeah! Ugh. Hell fucking yes. Oh god. Yeah, sniffing that fucking onion.
Not the same.
No, not the same in a cyborg body. Not the same in a cyborg body.
We have located the two agents threatening the frame.
Oh, you've located them?
Aboard a S.H.I.E.L.D. jet.
Okay, so they're
once
still
we
in
get
the
air. A lock on it, my men have orders.
Oh, yeah, they can still blow it out. They can still blow it out the sky. Oh, they can still blow it out the sky. Ah, oh, god damn it. God damn it. God damn it. Wow, yeah, okay, very good re-entry back into the show. Very good, very well handled episode. Yeah, that opening, it definitely, like I mentioned, that opening definitely hits harder after having watched the Matrix trailer. Because that trailer was much more fresh in my mind, I just couldn't help but see, oh, Maze turning into Trinity and doing flips, or even turning into Neo and doing flips, and you're like cartwheel shots in midair and boom, boom, pow, just unleashing bullets. And even them going, I think they had like somewhat of an opportunity there to actually reenact some kind of a lobby fight scene, like a fight scene in that kind of office complex in the style of the lobby fight scene from the Matrix, like them two just running along the walls and doing cartwheels and doing like kick flips off the wall and everything. They had the opportunity, but I think they minimized it down. Try to still maintain it into an actual Agent S.H.I.E.L.D. Thing, because they're not in like they are in an alternate virtual reality, but they're not in a they're not necessarily in an actual physics defying reality. So that's the worst. But then I think maybe it makes sense. She would absolutely utilize you for the opportunity to actually do some kind of cool flip and do some kind of dual wielded gunshot kind of thing. So that was cool. I mean, I felt like even without having watched the trailer for the Matrix, I still would have at least visualized it, if not mention something. But I think having that trailer in like fresh in my mind definitely kind of made me think, oh yeah, this is going to Matrix style now. And even Daisy having the opportunity to actually dual wield some guns too, definitely helped in that visual. But they did it. They both kind of broke out, just like the badass beautiful angels that they are. They both broke out and did it. And I think I loved that too, like the whole kind of teamwork aspect between them, between May and Daisy, them teaming up, even in the framework, them finally breaking out and waking up and everything. And them two being together, just fighting hordes of Hydra and escaping Hydra's clutches, and just being mother and daughter, just said that they're them two just kind of kicking ass and just being great. I loved it so much. So that was good. That was cool. And then yeah, Daisy actually had her quake powers in the framework too, and she utilized it beautifully. She actually just sent, you know, Ophelia flying like straight out the window. I mean, and I think it's because it's a virtual. I think for one thing, it's a virtual reality, but also it's because it's Ophelia. Like I think Ada herself would never let herself actually be able or be allowed. Ada would never allow herself to be killed so easily. Because I think anyone else in that position would have easily had their right, like had their head caved in and blood just pouring rapidly around it. I think, but with Ada, she gets away with two spine vertebrae broken and some bruises around the skin and everything. She gets away with that. But anyone else in that position, like any one of those two Hydra agents, if they were the ones blown out that window, they would be human mush on the floor. So, you know, that is. And she didn't even have anything to cushion her for. Like, I think I'm pretty sure in the framework, like Ada in the real world wants what she has in the framework. In the framework, she is still like an actual regular human. But then it's because Ada, she built herself with some enhancements or some kind of additional security that would allow her to not be killed like an actual regular human. So because of that, she's lucky enough to actually survive that kind of a fall. I'm kind of curious. That, I mean, I feel like maybe internally the doctors were questioning, like, you know, how the hell did she survive a fall? But then they didn't say anything out loud, because then, you know, they knew that Dr. Fitz was already pissed off enough that someone actually did this. But then if they actually kind of questioned his love of his life, the love of his framework, life's kind of stability and strength and everything, and then that would have gotten them killed. So her Terogenesis, Daisy's Terogenesis still works in the framework, so I think those laws still apply. So Terogenesis definitely still can happen within the framework. And her powers work just the same too, so that's a nice kind of reassurance that she can still very much be Quake. She can be just as powerful as Quake, and even her wounds, her cuts and bruises still heal up very nicely in the framework too, so that's cool. That's very, very cool. And then, yeah, so we have Sunil Bakshi. We have Bakshi alive and rather unfortunately well in the framework. He is a news anchor now. He is the one and only news anchor for the Hydra world. And I think one thing that got to me, I actually misinterpreted how this was originally presented, because the later it's revealed to actually be Victoria Hand, which I'll get to in a minute, but I think I actually initially, misinterpreted how this was presented the first time around, but I think that screen, the TV feedback screen that showed the Bakshi report also had a picture of John Garrett, and actually said, John Garrett, American hero. So I think given that Hydra is happily presenting that on their news, on their kind of media, I think that probably means that, Garrett was undoubtedly still Hydra in this world, and then because of his work for Hydra, which is probably also unashamedly public too, he probably is also being regarded as an American hero in their eyes because of what he does for Hydra. So yeah, John Garrett is still alive, but he is completely disconnected from Grant Ward in any way, shape, or form. So he's just a solo Hydra agent doing Hydra stuff. So only that kind of glimpse, though. No actual name drops, no references, no nothing. So that's John Garrett. So he is an American hero for Hydra. So that's great. That's great. And then, in the wake of Ophelia's new injury and her inability to actually then continue performing as the known head of Hydra, then Fitz's father promotes him and actually says, like we still need a new head. So now Fitz is the new head. And I think I swear to fucking Christ, but I think it was bad enough watching him staring at his father that way, like that side profile. Because I mean, Ian de Keyser has one hell of a fucking side profile, but seeing his eyes glinting in the sun. But then his eyes, not even glinting in a beautiful way, but in a beautiful way, sure. But then, seeing that darkness and anger in his eyes, that was bad enough. But then as soon as his dad actually, tells him, you are now the new head of Hydra, and then he turns around, he looks at the camera, he's looking down at the camera and sharpening his suit. He's looking into the camera through to your very soul. That is what he's doing. He's looking into your soul as the new head of Hydra. I have never been more terrified to look into a person's eyes in my life, like a human's eyes. We've had plenty of different kind of things where we've had to look into like a monster's eyes or some kind of creature's eyes, and it's terrifying. But that is one of the most terrifying times I've ever looked into another human being's eyes. So that speaks volumes. Like Ian de Keyser's acting is not just in his voice or his screaming or his shouting or anything like that, but it's when he's, especially when he's actually being told the news about Ophelia's condition afterwards, and his fists are just shaking and bald, and he's struggling to contain his anger and everything, but then his voice is calm and his face is blank, and he's like, leave now. I won't ask you again. If I have to ask you again, my fist is going to end up in your face. So just leave. Like that kind of anger being presented so flawlessly, so brutally, and just so in a way that you just know what's going on deep inside. Inside he is just smashing things. But it's like Kylo Ren's breakdown in Star Wars when he finds out Rey's gone, he just starts slicing up the console with his lightsaber, and then there's two stormtroopers actually come in, take a look, and then they're like, nope, don't want to deal with that, and they just actually walk away. Like that is what's happening inside of Dr. Fitz's mind in that very moment. Like he's just smashing up his internal controls and everything with a lightsaber of his own making. And then of course when he actually looks into the camera finally, all hail the new head of Hydra, all hail the new head. He just like his eyes, his face is one expressive mofo. His face is one expressive mofo. So he knows exactly what to do to give you chills. He knows exactly what to do. So Fitz now the new head. He is the new head of Hydra. So oh fucking god. So yeah, and one thing I really, really, really wanted to address as soon as I heard it. Ward's backstory was ever so slightly flipped. So I think they really upgraded it. That's an upgrade. I consider that to be a massive, massive upgrade. His past was mostly kind of similar. He did. I think it's safely presumable that he did go through the same abuse at his parent at the hands of his parents and older brother that he went through in the real world too. But then, and he still ended up in juvie too for like arson and stuff, and he was going to be tried as an adult and everything, so all that stuff still happened. But then the person who walked in the door was different, was drastically different and unarguably so much better. The person who met him this time was not, you know, John Garrett, but it was the lovely, the audacious, the magnificent, the fantastic Victoria mother freaking Hand. Victoria Hand was the one who walked in and offered him a chance to join S.H.I.E.L.D. So he was taken into better hands, into the right hands from the get-go, and he was shown how to be a Batman. He was shown how to actually be a good person, to actually look out for others, and to put himself to put others above himself, and to fight for a worthy cause, and to be a good man, and shown that he was actually worthy of being part of a family and a team and everything. So that is the reason Framework Ward is such a good guy. He was recruited and mentored, and possibly even mentored by Victoria Hand herself. And I mean, it was mostly based off my theory that I was kind of waiting for that kind of John Garrett reveal. But then this makes even more sense. I think that was when my mind flashed back to seeing John Garrett, American Hero, on the Hydra News thing, and then that was when I realized, oh, I probably misinterpreted that completely. He's probably still Hydra, and then in their eyes, because he's an American Hero. So then in this case, yeah, roles are not necessarily flipped, but I think positions and actions and choices are definitely flipped. So then they took good things out of Fitz's life, and then they put good things into Ward's life. They took good things out of Fitz's life, and they put the good things into Ward's life. And everything. I think I like the way that reveal was going. I was so kind of prepared and so kind of expectant because of my own theories. I was so prepared to actually hear that John Garrett was the one who did it. But then no. And then even the way that Ward actually phrased it, Coulson not knowing it was Garrett, not thinking it was Garrett, but just Coulson just assuming it was like a guy who walked in the door and then recruited him, and then, you know, Ward being like, oh yeah. She'd be offended to even hear that you think she was a man, or that she'd like they was automatically like a man who showed me a better path or showed me a better way. And it was like, no, it was, her name was Victoria Hand. She showed me the true kind of path to justice and good things and freedom and everything. So yeah, just, oh god, it feels so good to be proven wrong. I have never felt happier to be proven wrong on my own theory. Like, okay, I mean, I on the one hand, I was expecting, I mean, and I think, As soon as he said that, in my mind, I was like, okay, well, oh, so it was a she. Please be Victoria Hand. Like, I didn't want to say it out loud in case it jinxed it, or like it actually kind of turned out to be someone else. I mean, I don't know who else it could have been. There could have been no one else, because Victoria Hand was the only other kind of high operating female S.H.I.E.L.D. agent and S.H.I.E.L.D. operative. So, like, saying it out loud would have only confirmed my internal kind of thought process. But I was like, in my head, as soon as he said, oh, like, you know, she'd be offended to hear you say that, I was like, oh, please be Victoria Hand, please be Victoria Hand. And then, yeah, I've never been happy to be proven wrong on my own theory. Like, okay, you want to take John Garrett out, fine, because it's clear here that he's still kind of like a Hydra scumbag and he's all this and that. But then, you know, you want to bring back Victoria Hand in a way that actually makes the future a better place like this, then by all means. I mean, would have loved to see her, because I think, you know, S.H.I.E.L.D. started with the SO that poisoned Ward's mind coming in and having plenty of screen time along with her. But, you know, would have been great to actually know that she still made it. But I think knowing that the fall of S.H.I.E.L.D. actually still happened in this world, I think it's probably likely that she herself actually died, which, again, doesn't make things better, still being robbed of some, you know, Victoria Hand content and everything. But knowing that she was like that she actually helped Ward get off the wrong path, and knowing she had that kind of an impact on him, definitely a plus. Definitively a plus. So Yeah, Victoria Hand, and yeah, I think that would have been. I think I actually kind of want a backstory about that. I think I want like maybe some flashbacks, like at the very least flashbacks. But I also can't help but kind of try and visualize like an actual kind of backstory, like an actual kind of. I can't help but like envision a season one of this show, of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. that would have actually like taken place the way that. Like in a way that it actually impacts season four, because season four is now the present day. But then I can't help it, like given how different things are now in the present day for season four, I can't help but try and visualize like a season one that would have taken place that would actually then help set the stage for what season four is, and then to help set the stage for what, well, not season four rather, but actually a season one of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. that actually helps set the stage framework and stuff. So actually seeing Victoria Hand coming in, actually being an SO for Grant Ward, and then all these things happening. I mean, I feel like, you know, I think, I mean, I'm saying season one, but I think in the grand scheme of things, that alone is like just like one part of like a whole collection of different events and like one giant plot with other subplots kind of mixed in that make up season one. So I think that's just me kind of being more idealistic than anything else. But regardless, I really want to see those flashbacks. I mainly just want to see Victoria Hand again, but still, I actually want to know how that backstory would have gone down, how that interaction would have gone down, because we've seen exactly what it was like when Garrett first recruited Ward and he first brought him in, so I actually want to see the flip side of that, and actually see what it was like when Victoria Hand visited him and actually told him of a better way and a better life, and actually promised him that, you know, he'd actually learn to be a man in the right way, to be a good man and to actually help people and to be that kind of force for good and everything. So yeah, you can't tease me with those crumbs and then not give them to me, Marvel TV. That's not how this works. That's not even how S.H.I.E.L.D. works. Usually they actually do kind of tease you with like the actual kind of verbal kind of setup to begin with, and then somewhere down the line they actually give you the visualization that then actually works as payoff. So I don't know, maybe hopefully a flashback. I'm fingers crossed for a flashback scene of Victoria Hand training and mentoring Framework Grant Ward. So maybe, just maybe, but honestly, just knowing that Victoria Hand had that kind of a hand, no pun intended, in or maybe pun intended if you want those pun intended, had a hand in actually training Ward and actually building him up and actually being still a prominent member of S.H.I.E.L.D. again, is really, really cool. So yeah, I guess we'll see. I guess we'll see moving forward if we do get the flashback. Or maybe, I honestly don't even know if they actually mentioned that she died or if we're meant to assume that she kind of died in the fall of S.H.I.E.L.D. I think the writers are probably kind of trusting us to put that two and two together, but I'm hoping not. But I mean, I feel like if she was around, then we probably would have seen her by now, but again, never say, we've still got a good few episodes to go, so never say never, so, yeah, oh god, I just really want to see Hand again, but I guess we shall see, but yeah, but that reveal from Grant actually came with a reveal from Coulson as well. That reveal came with a surprising reveal from Coulson. I mean, it was actually instigated by a reveal from Coulson. And that Coulson, before he became a teacher, he was actually, when he was fresh out of school, he was actually approached by S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. He was actually approached by a man from S.H.I.E.L.D. to actually join them and to join their cause and everything. But then he said no. He said no because he didn't believe in himself enough. He didn't really feel too confident. He didn't really feel like he could actually make it as a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. Maybe so. He said no, but then now he kind of wishes he did. Now he actually wonders how different his life could have been if he actually did join up with them. So I mean that alone is an interesting tidbit. But then that also does kind of raise, and naturally that raises questions about how that would have gone down. And like, yeah, I mean, yeah, because I mean, him saying fresh out of school kind of like somewhat reminds me of Fury's backstory from Captain Marvel, where he actually mentions that. I mean, for Fury, he said he was a soldier. He was a soldier straight out of high school, but then as he built up the ranks there, he then eventually joined. He eventually became a spy. He eventually kind of joined S.H.I.E.L.D. like soon after that. And then even in Captain Marvel, he's a veteran S.H.I.E.L.D. agent too. He's actually ready to leave before Carol and her space shenanigans come down to play. So then naturally I then wonder, because then even when Coulson joined S.H.I.E.L.D., he was working under Fury. He was pretty much like a second in command, or like some kind of like he was an agent under him. He was actually working directly for Fury. So then I wonder, could it have been Fury who approached him, or could it have been something else? I imagine it would have to be Fury. I imagine it kind of would have to be Fury. But he never directly mentioned it. I don't think he actually directly mentioned who it was. He just had an old badge, which I think probably could have been his, because I think he did have a badge at the end in the news announcement. But I think the badge he was kind of holding in the actual office, I don't know if that was his, or maybe if he was. I think he was packing up like Mesa stuff to put together like some kind of like memorial or something for like his belongings. So I don't know about that. But then he did have his own shield badge by the end of it. So I think I'm wondering if maybe they made one quickly for him, or maybe if that was like one they had before. But I think probably like it being the framework, I think it would make more sense for it to be one that like is his, one that was actually made for him. So yeah, that's that. But yeah, no, I just can't really help but wonder who actually approached him and who it was and like what they told him and stuff. And actually, and then yeah, like I think that kind of backstory would be cool too. But then I think it's definitely like a different kind of parallel, wherein like, you know, he like in the framework he actually says no initially because he's too afraid and he doesn't really think he can actually stand up for it, and he doesn't really think he make a good fit for it. But then in the real world, I think it's been a while since I've actually watched Captain Marvel. So not too long ago. I think I actually watched it for like the fourth time last month. But you know, and I think in that one, I think I can't remember if they actually mentioned how he joined, or if he volunteered himself, or if someone actually went up to him because of his history in the army, or in like the government or something, and then he actually did it. Because I don't think Coulson ever actually had a history of being a soldier. I don't know if he actually ever had a history of being in the military or being something else. I think maybe his father might have been a soldier, because then him watching his father die for him was like a defining moment, like his father putting his life on the line, I think it was, and then actually him watching his father fight for a cause, I think like that was his defining moment. So I think his father must have been in the army or must have been in like some kind of high profile job like that. But I don't know or think that Coulson himself has had any jobs in the military, or any jobs like Fury has. But I can't remember if they actually mentioned how Coulson joined, but I think only that it was actually like he was a new, I think he was a newbie. Fury was a veteran, but then Coulson was a newbie, so he was very new to that kind of agency and that kind of business and everything, so that was different for him. But this one he actually was approached, but then he said no. So yes, I mean, if that kind of if the stuff for Ward is flipped, then I guess then I have to think that the stuff for Coulson is flipped too, because then I think that would probably mean that I don't know actually, because then if it's when he's fresh out of school, then that would be. But then what do they mean by school? Because I think Americans can mean various things by school, because I think Americans can still kind of refer to college as school. So maybe he's actually great, like if he went to college, if he graduated college, or maybe if he actually was like a high school graduate, maybe then if he actually was asked, and then after that. Or maybe the change, because I think it's meant to be changes that affect them, so maybe it's not just him saying no, maybe it's actually the fact that he's asked earlier too, so maybe in the real world, he was actually asked a lot later in life, once he was actually more sure of what he wanted to do, once he actually had a bit more confidence, but then in the framework, he was actually asked a lot earlier when he actually wasn't sure of himself, and he wasn't sure what he wanted to do, and he wasn't sure if he was ready for that kind of a career or like that kind of line of work. So then because of that, he said no. But then in the real world, he's asked a lot later once he's matured a bit more, and then he's actually ready to fight and everything. So that could have been the case. So Coulson in this world was offered the chance, and he initially declined, and then. Now the framework has proven that it's his destiny to fight with the good guys, to fight with S.H.I.E.L.D., to be a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent and everything. So yeah, we will see exactly how his future in the framework goes. So yeah. And then yeah, then we have May's kind of guilt. May's guilt over being the one responsible for killing the Patriot, for killing Mace, for killing the Patriot, because she ordered that kind of missile strike. directly through Fitz. So she was responsible for those kids being injured and being trapped, and then Mace going in and doing all that stuff. And you know, like Mac just finding May, and then finding May and Daisy, and like, and being like, you know, I'm here to save you, but her, she was responsible for killing May. Something I can't be entirely sure that she's actually on our side. And then Coulson jumping in, like, you know, like rushing from the gun and actually being adamant on saving her life and everything. So May, yeah, I mean, yeah, again, I mean, May, I think they very, I think even Daisy, I think even Daisy herself, I think I'm loving various things about this arc, right? I'm loving various things, and especially as a reactor, I am just cherishing the reactions to Daisy and Simmons finding out various things. I mean, the reactions vice versa, like Daisy and Simmons finding out, did Daisy and Simmons' reactions finding out things about the framework, and also people in the framework who either haven't woken up yet or people who are elements of the framework finding out things about the real world too, like those reactions, like, you know, like Daisy and Simmons' kind of reactions to finding out that Tripp is alive and that Ward is alive and all these different things, and everything, like those reactions are actually just, you know, just giving me energy and everything. So that's pretty cool. And like Daisy finding out that Tripp is alive still, and he's like, oh great, I get my best buddy back. I get my best buddy that I was robbed of in the second season of this show, and everything. So we still haven't seen them actually meet. I think he and Simmons actually went out on that recon mission to the Baltic Sea, so to the Baltic Sea. So we still haven't seen the meeting. So that I'm waiting for that. I am waiting for that Daisy and Tripp reunion. Okay. So really can't wait for the coming episodes for that. So that is going to be fun. So yeah, there's that, and then just various characters finding out various bits of information, both about the framework and the real world. Like those reactions are really kind of really really fun to see. So that's cool. And yeah, like, May's guilt over killing, and I think also Daisy's more kind of painful reaction to finding out that Mace is dead, because then, I think for May, it's like, you know, oh, I know he was an important person to the Resistance, and he was, like, the director of the Resistance, and the leader of S.H.I.E.L.D. and everything, so I know that's painful, but then for Daisy being awake and self-aware in the framework, she knows, oh, she remembers the rule, oh, if you die in the framework, you die in real life. So it's like, great, so when we go back, we're going to go back to Mace's dead body, because he's gone now, so we've lost one. So that kind of reaction just hits harder than May realizes. So yeah, that one is a reaction I was looking forward to a little bit less, but I mean, she is still important to know, it's still important for her to know when she loses a team member, so that much is true. But yeah, no, so there's that, and then May's actual guilt over killing Mace too, like she kind of like her guilt actually being the cause of that, and then her now being willing to do that, to do whatever it takes to solidify a place within S.H.I.E.L.D., but also to redeem herself in the eyes of S.H.I.E.L.D. and actually to do whatever she can to help them take down Hydra too. So then actually releasing the body cam footage to show that, you know, like Hydra actually collapsed that building full of innocent kids and even killed the Patriot and everything and actually did all that stuff, so yeah, I mean, and I think even Daisy reassuring May that, you know, you did not know what you were doing when you went in there, you didn't know the full extent of the damage you were doing, especially when you called in that strike, you were just following orders, even her knowing that she was going up against the Patriot, you know, she was thinking that, oh, she's being an even more efficient Hydra agent, and actually getting the job done, actually impressing her bosses over Hydra and everything, so she thought that was what was happening. But no, now she knows everything. Even Daisy's lying, like, you know, you can't blame yourself for the lies that they're telling you. Like, you can't blame yourself for believing their lies, but you also can't and shouldn't blame yourself for the lies that they're selling you. Like, you know, like, they are intentionally kind of, you know, like, coaxing you and goading you and forcing you to believe in all of their kind of, in all of their wrongdoings and all of their misdeeds and all of their kind of hateful kind of ideologies and everything, so you can't hate yourself for all the stuff you've done under their control now, because that is exactly what you've been. You've been under their control. You haven't had a choice. You've been misled to believe one thing after the other. So seeing that kind of effect, seeing that taking effect on May was interesting too. So yeah, I'm hoping now. I think now going forward, they have like somewhat of like an actual stronger S.H.I.E.L.D. team to actually help take down Hydra and everything. So yeah, And yeah, more stuff with Fitz and his father. Fitz's father is, you know, maybe not alcoholic in this universe, but still just as physically aggressive and angry and brutal and everything. Him beating the absolute shit out of Radcliffe. I mean, we didn't even see the after product. We just saw the bruises and burn on his actual knuckles. We didn't even see what kind of a mess Radcliffe was at the end of his treatment. But, you know, he literally just kind of, you know, floored him from the chair to the ground and then actually went at his face with his knuckles and everything. So, can't imagine it looked or felt too good. So there's that. But yeah, no, I think even in this one too, it's like, I think what got to me was, you know, I think Fitz's anger is one thing. Like Fitz's darkness, his anger, his kind of overall aggression and like his attitude and mood in this one. That's one thing, right? But what they went even further to establish in this was that Fitz can't even snap at his own dad. He can't even lash out, or he still can't stand up to his own dad. He just follows him. He believes everything he says. He like Fitz's dad is one. He's it's like his own form of Hydra that Fitz then kind of follows into and everything, and stuff. So he no matter how angry Fitz gets, he can only get angry at like other Hydra agents or people below him. He can never get angry at his own father. If he does actually lash out, then Fitz's dad steps a few notches up, and he's like, you know, be careful how you speak to me, boy. I'm still your fucking father, and everything. And even then, it's like Fitz actually being like, okay, shit, I forgot, I'm sorry, and stuff. Actually apologizing, actually stepping down. You can his body language, like as a whole, when he actually lashes out, Fitz is stern and he's straight, and he's actually, you know, he's standing up and he's actually, you know. He's actually, you know, like up front and everything, but then when his dad actually pushes him back down again, he's actually cowering and he's actually turning away and he's actually stumbling back and forth and everything. So that kind of like that whole scene, the way that scene flowed, the way those two actors actually did it, it really gets the point across. It really gets the message across that, you know, like no matter how angry Fitz gets at anyone else, no matter how much power Fitz thinks he has, he can still never overpower his own dad. His own dad, I mean, like, his dad even believes, you know, his dad believes that he's the only reason. Like, he even said, like, you know, like, you know, you know, I think he mentioned it, like, you know, like, it's why he had, like, I think he mentioned it, I can't remember exactly what the line was, but he actually mentioned something about, like, you know, like, not having left him with his mother, if I wanted someone who failed, or if I wanted someone who was lesser than I would have left you with your mother. So I mean, basically confirming that he actually did take him with him. So Fitz's father left his mother, but then he actually took Fitz with him. So then Fitz's mother was left to fend for herself and to look after herself and everything. But then he actually took Fitz with him. So he said, you know, if I wanted someone soft who failed and did everything wrong, then I would have actually left you with your mother and just, you know, seen how you fared then. But so yeah, so I mean, he raised Fitz. He definitely still abused Fitz to that very same extent, but in the way that, you know, he raised Fitz to earn and to actually grasp his own power and to be that force of power and anger and danger. But then he also raised him with that reminder, like, you know, no matter how powerful you get, don't ever try and step up to me, because I'm the one who made you this way. I'm the man who raised you to be this way. So you remember who's still really in charge here. So That one scene, executing that message flawlessly. Good God, just, you know, the writing, the directing, the acting, just just the way that scene is set up and executed, just, you know, just, oh God. I still can't give a how fluidly and how flawlessly he actually transfers from body language. Like, he thinks because he's angry, he's entitled to lash out and he's entitled to actually step up to him, but then it's like he's reminded, oh, he's talking to his father. It's like, okay, you know what, fine, that's the one line. He can never step up to his father and stuff. So even then his father, you know, like his father doesn't even recognize his power. He's just like, oh sure, you have power, that's cute, but I'm still your father, so you will respect me, or I will, you know, make sure that, you know, you once again understand exactly where you do stand and everything. So, and I think deep down he even believes that he's the only reason that, you know, I think deep down he believes that, you know, that he is the only reason that Fitz is even actually in this position to begin with. I think he likely believes that, you know, like, without his teaching, without him teaching fits the things he did. He never would have had the courage or the confidence to actually grasp power in Hydra the way that he did, to actually become this high of a level. So he's like, you know, like, everything you are now, you owe me. You owe me that. So he's still kind of just like abusing him on that much, much deeper level. So yeah, just wow. Just, yeah. So now, even with him being the new head of Hydra, he still can never be allowed to step above his dad. But then he did still say I'm not gonna I'm the new head of Hydra, so that means I am not under any circumstances gonna tolerate failure, even from my own father. So I thought that meant, like, when he said that, I thought he was gonna turn around and throw something at his father's head or something, or actually just pull out a gun and shoot him or something. Like, he was like, oh, because then that kind of message would be clear, like, you know, failure would be punishable by death. So I thought, oh, maybe he's then gonna actually try and kill his father or something. But no, he just kind of passed that message on, like, you know, oh, so, well, you know, I just be aware that I am now the new head of Hydra. So if you fail to get me what I want, to get me the intel, or to do what I ask of you, then, you know, I am the head of Hydra, and I still need to set an example. So I will not hesitate to put you down if need be as well. And yeah, then from Radcliffe, we also find out that the guy's real name is Alistair. I don't know if they actually mentioned that before, but I think this is the first time I remember hearing about it. His name is Alistair Fitz. So yeah, I don't know if we actually have a name for his mother. I don't know if we've actually had a name for his mother yet. But yeah, so Alistair Fitz, and then we have Leopold, and then the mother. If it has been mentioned before, then feel free to let me know in the comments. If it has been mentioned in a previous season, but I'm just not remembering it, then absolutely feel free to let me know in the comments. But if it hasn't, then I will find out when I find out. Don't worry, I will find out whenever I find out in the show, whenever they decide to reveal it. So more than happy to wait until then. But if it has been revealed, then by all means, I've definitely forgotten it. So by all means, let me know. Alistair Fitz, just as angry and as controlling and abusive as ever. I think because of that, I can't really see him surviving the end of this. I can't really see him surviving the end of the framework arc. And I think especially because of Fitz's words to him, like, you know, I can't tolerate failure. I can't tolerate any failure whatsoever, even from my own father. So I think because of that, but also combined with the fact that Alistair still doesn't respect him, like I think Alistair is still going around with the idea that Fitz's success and Fitz's power now is due to his Alistair's methods and his ways of raising his son. Like he still believes that he's owed that kind of gratitude and his own position. And I think he believes he's owed his own position of power within Hydra. Like, you know, he taught Fitz to take control and to be assertive and to never show weakness. I think he believes that he's owed that much. I think because of that, he then shows that little amount of respect towards Fitz, both in front of and behind the backs of other Hydra agents. And then I think because of that, Fitz might then come to realize that, you know, like, in order to actually show true lack of weakness and to actually assert himself as a true leader, I think he might end up killing his own father. I think maybe one more failure or one more thing he deems as a failure, and he might end up actually killing his own father. So yeah, I think it then shows that, you know, like, then his father will have that much less control over him, and he'll actually be able then to actually be like a true, more comfortable kind of head of Hydra without his father lurking over his shoulder and actually kind of just spectating and commentating over every little thing he does, and even actually putting him down when he kind of feels like it and everything. So I just really can't see him surviving the end of the framework or the end of the season anyway. And yeah, then the other team we had was Triplet and Gemma. And they got along swellingly. And I think this time it definitely, not to say that it didn't work the first time around, because I think that time, you know, Fitz had his own issues of jealousy and insecurity and his lack of courage and everything that eventually led up to that underwater reveal. But you know, I think this time it undeniably works a lot better, knowing that they're all kind of much more mature and stable. And, well, I wouldn't say stable, but I think now they're much more mature and semi-comfortable adults now. You know, Fitz is much more secure in her love for Gemma and her love life with Gemma. And now I think now, now I think now um I mean, well, I think at least now, I think. Well, I think, yeah, okay, so see, right, I think now, because I think even back then, I think Gemma really never really had an established, I think maybe a crush at the very least, maybe a crush on like a fellow kind of agent and like a fellow friend and everything, but then beyond that, she never really had any kind of established kind of feelings or affections for Trip beyond liking him as an actual kind of genuine guy and a friend and everything, and I think even now, it's like, even now having Trip back just gives her that chance to actually reignite that friendship she once had with him and to interact with him in that way again. So I think seeing them together definitely had that kind of vibe, like, oh, this is the friendship that they once had, this is a friendship that she once had that she then lost back in season 2, so now she gets to reignite that friendship and reignite that kind of chemistry with Trip again. And Trip is just a guy made of compassion and solid chemistry with everyone. Like he gets along with all the people that he needs to get along with, and he's a good guy. He, you know, he loves everyone. He treats them all like equals and like friends and family and everything. So it's really easy for them to actually get that thing going again. And I think especially what I love even more is that, you know, like he believes Gemma right off the bat. No questioning how, like, whether or not she's the sane one, or whether or not she's the insane one, or whether or not, like, the details of her story are really true. Like, he's like, you know what, the things we've been going through, crazy things have happened, and there's no, and also, like, him saying, like, you know, there's no way you could actually make up a story that crazy, so I'm with you with whatever you need to do. So, you know, he's like, you know, I mean, I think the only thing I loved more than that line was him being like, you know what, I don't fully get what you're saying, but I'm in, you son of a bitch, I'm in, I'm on board with whatever you want to do, I've got your back, I've got your six, you know, I've got your cover fire, whatever you need, I'm in. Like, he's all in. He's in there for his friends. He's, you know, whatever his friends need. So long as it's ethical and stuff, he's all in. So I think those two lines, I actually love, like, him believing her right off the bat, because in his eyes, no one could actually make up a story that crazy, but also because she's a friend and she's an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. and everything, he's like, you know what, not fully following all the signs and stuff you're saying, but regardless, you need help, I'm the helping hand. So I think because of that, I really look forward to seeing him getting back to S.H.I.E.L.D. and actually meeting Daisy again and meeting and seeing everyone else and actually getting back with them. So then by that time the S.H.I.E.L.D. team will fully reassemble and they'll be able to do some cool stuff. So that will be really fun. But yeah, Trip and Gemma in this were just a sight. They were the pure gold. So I love that. And yeah, Fitz finally did it after numerous kind of back and forth with Ophelia actually kind of asking him and begging him to finish the project and to actually go ahead and to not let anything stop him. He finally, after various back and forths in his holographic table lab thing, he finally actually went ahead and completed Project Looking Glass. It looks like a cylindrical kind of TARDIS, like not necessarily bigger on the inside, but I think even. From the pictures that Trip actually took of those designs, I think Simmons even said it's like a quantum energy machine thing, and I think those boxes look very, it looked like similar, at least the plans, like those actual picture plans actually look similar to the same kind of boxes, and the formation looked very similar to the actual portal boxes thing that Ada built in the real world to bring Coulson and Robbie and Fitz back from the other deeper kind of darker dimension thing. So I think I'm wondering maybe if this portal is meant to work that similar way, because I think essentially I think especially because of the enhancement from the Darkhold, I think essentially on top of this being virtual reality, I think this could essentially also be seen as an actual kind of alternate dimension too, like an alternate dimension powerful enough to actually let complex kind of algorithms and complex kind of existences actually take place, and they're all allowed to coexist on like a massive scale at like a massive kind of like a real time thing. So because of that, I feel like, you know, it's really like because of that I think that same interdimensional kind of box thing could work, but then because of the framework, they also need like an actual bigger portal, like a bigger, more complex portal for it to work. So I think it's like, you know, like that kind of ring portal thing, like Doctor Strange was actually like a, it was suitable for that, but then for this they need something bigger that would allow all of them, even Hydra themselves, to actually pass through and go through. So it's like a cylindrical TARDIS that where the thing moves up and down and everything. So Simmons would not be pleased. Simmons would not be pleased with like the TARDIS being kind of desecrated by this kind of by this agenda and this kind of intention and this kind of design and everything. So no Whovian would. No Whovian would appreciate this. But yeah, that is that. So then he did it, and then through deducing the kind of full scale of the project and the full scale of the machinery and then the kind of tech and intention behind the machinery, Simmons then actually deduces that Ada then wants to be able to actually not just bring Hydra over into the real world, but then actually kind of bring her real body into the real world too. Like Ada wants that human, organic kind of real life kind of body, and not to have to be an android, and not to be have to be an LND forever. So she actually wants to bring her real, her more organic human body over from the framework into the real world too. So then she brings Dr. Fitz over from the real world. She brings Hydra over from the real world and everything. So she does all of that, and then finally she actually manages to actually bring her own organic body over from the real world. So then that happens, and then she finally gets to be a human again. She gets to be a human woman this time. So that is and now Fitz is finished. Fitz has finished the design. So I think the actual kind of building of the actual building of Project Looking Glass hasn't completed. But I think that is what is happening in the real world. That is actually not happening yet. So I think maybe it can't be opened from inside the framework. It actually has to be opened from the outside and then connected into the framework, and then that's how that happens. It started longer, so I think likely with her being the one to initiate this project and her being the one to start it, she would know exactly how it would need to work and how it would need to look and how it would need to be built. So then I trust because of that she knows exactly. I think then the way that even Fitz himself has completed the project, I think that kind of probably works in coherence and coexistence with the actual one being built in the real world. Gemma and Trip actually travel to the Baltic Sea, travel to the oil drilling platform thing. I knew they weren't going to find anything, because then the color grading switched too. Like the framework itself has a very very different, much more noticeably bleaker and different kind of color grading compared to the real world. Like even the real world, even within. Ivanov's kind of drilling platform actually has like a lighter, more vibrant kind of color grading, whereas the framework has the different ones. So then once these scenes actually switch back and forth, and even the colors switch back and forth, I was like, okay, this doesn't match at all. Like it doesn't actually match at all. So then once they go in and there's nothing there on their end, that's when Gemma then deduces that, you know, oh, so it's not being built here. It's being built in the other world. And then once it actually gets up and running on the other world, that's when it will actually activate and then connect into the framework, and then transfer can be made possible soon enough after that. So, Project Looking Glass is pretty much ready. It's pretty much ready. So they've got one hell of a fight on their hands. They have got a fight and a half on their hands. And then, Framework Ward. Yeah, again, it's like the Framework arc has me rooting for Ward. It has me rooting for Grant Ward. And I think it's a well-founded rooting, because I think it's been well-established already. This is nowhere near the same Grant Ward that we had in the real world. Like, this is Framework Ward is the Ward that we could have had. In an ideal world, it's the Ward. I mean, granted, like, Evil Grant Ward is great. He's a compelling character. He's a great villain. He's a great villain first and foremost, and he's a compelling character and a character you disagree with a lot of the time because of who he is and what he does. But then, like, a good Grant Ward is also like a really interesting thing to explore. And in this one, they've just kind of really well established that, you know, he is really not the same Grant Ward that we as viewers and fans were bred to hate for like three full seasons and everything. So he's very very different from that kind of version. So because of that, it's like, you know, with this one he had, I think because this one we count our blessings that Hand got to him first and actually made sure that he turned out to be a good guy, because then he turned out to be a great guy. He helped people, he saved people, he, you know. And I think even this one, like, you know, even him explicitly pointing out to Daisy that, you know, Yeah, Gemma told me that guy, the Grant Ward from your world, he was a real son of a bitch, so don't worry, I hate him too, I hate him just as much as you do. But then even asking, did he get locked up? Did he actually pay for his crimes or something? And then Daisy's kind of silence, kind of showing him, oh, the other thing, so he actually died and stuff. So yeah, I think only Gemma told Coulson. Gemma told Coulson, oh, you killed him on an alien planet. So only Coulson actually knows what happened to the real Grant Ward. But then, this one just kind of knows that, okay, so if you didn't kill him, then you definitely wouldn't have kept him alive. You definitely would have actually made sure he kind of stayed down. So you definitely killed him. I think with this one too, it's like, I think it's not even a fact that he's trying too hard. I think he's trying hard enough. By nature, because the good nature in him was nurtured by S.H.I.E.L.D. and by Victoria Hand. I think because that he's now naturally a good guy. He's actually been shown a better way, and he's now naturally kind of more prone to helping people and to being good. So because of that, it's like, he's that much more kind of visibly kind of, good-willed and everything. But then also, I think now after having this kind of knowledge that there's a real world out there that he's not a part of. But then even a real world out there that he's no longer a part of. But even when he was a part of it, he wasn't good. He wasn't actually putting anything good into that world, and he was actually sucking the life out of it. And he was actually causing harm to everyone around him, and he was causing pain and destruction. So then because of that, he had to be put down. So actually knowing that there was another version of him out there that was actually the polar opposite and actually hurt everyone who ever cared about him. For him, and I think for a guy who spent so much of his life actually helping people and actually making people who cause other people pain actually pay for their crimes, it's hard for him to actually have to process that there's a version of him that's evil out there. Probably not hard to process because I think maybe part of him will put two and two together and be like, I ended up this good because Victoria Hand got to me and showed me a better way. But then clearly that guy didn't get that same kind of he didn't get that same luxury. Chances are he got someone worse, and then he ended up being worse because of it. So there's that. But then with this guy, you said, I think because he profusely not necessarily apologizes, but then because he profusely acknowledges that kind of side, that kind of version of him, and then he actually kind of like, he then visibly actually becomes even more kind of, actually well hinted towards his past, and he actually becomes more visibly kind of supportable. I think because of that, it's like, I wish we could keep this ward. I wish we could keep this ward. I wish we could keep this resurrected trip. I wish we could actually keep these guys because they are very, very much worth having around on the S.H.I.E.L.D. team. I wish we could keep them both, and stuff. So I mean, maybe in that case, Project Looking Glass isn't the worst. I mean, Project Looking Glass, I think maybe it could be used in that final way, like maybe actually bringing Trip and maybe using Project Looking Glass to actually bring Trip and Ward back to life, but in this form, actually maintaining them to be good people and maintaining them, or at least maintaining Ward to be good because Trip's already perfect, but maintaining Ward to be good and actually keeping him around as a good guy. Maybe that's actually not a half bad idea. Maybe that's actually worth doing. So then I wonder if Ada really wants to bring Hydra into the real world, then, because I think the Hydra in this are framework elements. The Hydra in the framework are not people plugged in. Those are framework elements. So then maybe if she wants to bring that over, but then I think. If she wants to, then I think she definitely would have actually made the framework powerful enough to actually bring that kind of that level of power and that level of actual living beings over. So then because of that, maybe Project Looking Glass would actually be kind of capable of actually bringing framework elements to life. So then maybe if they can do that, would they then contemplate actually bringing Ward and Trip through? Would they consider that, or would that be considered too dangerous? Maybe even bring one person is too risky, but then actually bringing two people through is that too? I'm not too sure, but it seems idealistic, but I can't help it. I got Trip back, and I actually found myself growing attached to a Ward that's actually good, and he's actually supportable, and he's actually one that's worth keeping around. So you can't give me 3 seasons of bad guy Ward, and then give me a quarter, like a third of a season of Good Guy Ward, and then expect me to let him go. You cannot make me endure three seasons of Evil Ward, and then give me a third of a season of Good Guy Ward, and then expect me to let him go just like that. Like a third of a season of Good Ward is not enough. Like Good Ward again, worth keeping around, worth having around, worth actually maintaining on the team, and actually rebuilding the Shield team that way. So yeah, I don't know. I do not know, but. I don't know, but goddamn, yeah, Good Guy Ward, Framework Ward, he misses Sky too. He really misses Sky. He misses his Sky, the Sky that was actually like the avatar that was there before Daisy jumped into her body through the framework. He misses her. Like he even says that, you know, I know I can't go with you. I know I'm not going with you, so you'll be going back to your world, and obviously I'll be staying in mine. But then, you know, like he even questions, like, you know, will I even get my Sky back? Like the girl he fell in love with, the girl he made memories with, the girl that he was actually there with, like is he gonna get her back? But then Daisy also pointed out that she was with Hydra too. But then I thought they were both. I think I think even originally Sky was meant to be with Hydra, but then because Daisy overtook her, then she was then all of a sudden like adapted to being undercover and stuff. So then Ward was the only actually on. Ward was the undercover one. Ward is what was the actual undercover Hydra mole and everything. So or Shield mole rather. So I think with this one, like the actual Sky avatar that was there. I think that one was actually probably kind of full on Hydra. So you know, even if he got back, he would have to actually try and convince her to actually join their side. But then that makes me wonder, right? Was the Sky avatar in human too, or was she only in human once Daisy? Because I think that Sky would have to be in human. Because then I think Ward even actually mentioned her test results from before. But then I think that had to be before Daisy jumped into her body, right? Because then that Sky would logically still be in humans, and she would still be in human. And then even then, I think afterwards the test results the test that Dr. Fitz ran. Should have offered in human, but then even then, like, I think in the very same episode that Daisy jumped into Sky's body, Ward actually mentioned having swapped out her DNA results for other results, because then the original test results showed her offers in humans. And I think, is it safe to assume that test was conducted before Daisy jumped into her body, or what? Because I think we never saw her undergoing any kind of testing for inhuman DNA, so I think it had to be maybe as part of like initiation or something. It had to be like a full body scan, to actually make sure she wasn't inhuman. So then, you know, he actually swaps out the results. So then, even if his guy was Hydra, like she'd still end up being human. Just like now, I think now because it's in her body, because they. Now, like, she's, like, it's Daisy's mind in Hydra Sky's body, so then it's still her body that's still inhuman, and then, like, her powers have now been activated, and her powers have still been charged up and everything, so even if Daisy kind of left this avatar's body, then Sky would return, but then she'd also still have her powers, like, she'd still have her Quake powers, apparently this guy is actually full on Hydra, so Hydra Sky with the Shield Mole Ward, so... So yeah, and yeah, I gotta say that final scene, Coulson's speech on the news, Coulson's broadcast. That was phenomenal. Like him unveiling that truth, him going on live, televised, television across the country, and it being blasted across every screen too. It being broadcast to Hydra, it being broadcast to the Quinjet, even Gemma and. Trip on the Quinjet, it being broadcast to Shield, and everywhere that there was a TV or a cell phone or whatever. I think maybe like cell phones and laptops, like anywhere there was an actual kind of like a signal that it could reach, then Coulson's message being broadcast there, and him unveiling the verbal red pill to the civilians of New York. New York was what came to mind, but the civilians of America as a whole, and maybe even, American TV very, very, very covers what happens outside of America, so I have no reason to, you know, believe that the framework even bothers to do that, so just as the civilians of America. Well, there's the Baltic Sea. There's the Baltic Sea, which is out somewhere out there. So, I mean, they go that far. They go that far. But either way, his broadcast reaching that many places and him unleashing the verbal red pill, actually telling people, you know, you need to wake up. Hydra has been feeding us lies from the beginning. They are fascist. They are just like an age-old cult and like a Nazi group mixed into one. They've been feeding us lies. They've been trying to torture people we love and people we know and... You know, like quarantining them and actually caging them up and doing experiments on them and actually experimenting on kids and controlling them and controlling all of us and the way that we live and you know, forcing us to live in fear and everything about Hydra, the enemy. We need to rise up and do it. And he said it a lot better. He said it a lot better. I can't remember his speech word for word. But then I think to top it all off, I think the music actually in it actually is actually hopeful and triumphant, and it builds up to that iconic S.H.I.E.L.D. theme. And it kicks off just as soon as he says, you know, I am Phil Coulson, and I am an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., and then it cuts to black, just as it should. And that is it. That is the ending. That is the pitch-perfect ending to top off the episode. And even as his speech is going on, Burroughs comes in to say that, you know, there's people outside, but they're not enemies, they're people. Like, they're people willing to join the Resistance, people who have been living under fear of Hydra, for years on end now, and people who are actually willing to join up with S.H.I.E.L.D., to join up with the Resistance and actually fight and pick up arms and help them fight and everything. So now, Coulson's speech. Coulson is a man of words. Phil Coulson is a man of words. Anyone who's watched season one will know. Season one and season two, I think he had some really, really fond words in season two. I think one of my favorite speeches of it, definitely like one of my favorite speeches of his from season two is from the episode with the Kree City, like him actually talking about the reason there's a S.H.I.E.L.D. Like, you know, like Bobby asking him, you know, like how he, like how she can be so sure that he's actually gonna do what he says he does and not do something else, and he's like, you know, like he's like, oh god, I don't even know if I can actually remember how this speech goes, but it's like, you know, like him being like, you know, vendors making him like bring home a modest income, locals picking up fresh fruit and vegetables, like him listing all the innocent people that are out here that could end up being collateral damage for Hydra in their search for power, but then he's not going to let that happen because that's the reason he's there and that's the reason there's a S.H.I.E.L.D. like that speech as a whole is also one of my favorite kind of moments from him too. And then of course his Agents of Nothing speech from season one too. He's a man of words. Like, long story short, Agent Phil Coulson is a man of words. He's a man of words, he's a man of wisdom, he's a man of movement and stuff, and he's a man of actual strength and courage and fighting the good fight. So, you know, no better way to end off this episode than him giving off that kind of final news speech and actually him announcing that S.H.I.E.L.D. is back and they're ready to fight, and anyone, and you know, like, Steve would be proud. Like Steve made his own announcement over the S.H.I.E.L.D. intercoms in Winter Soldier, and now Coulson is going on live television and actually handing out various batons from S.H.I.E.L.D. for people to help carry those batons and fight the good fight and help take down Hydra for good. So yeah, it feels good. It feels very, very good. And yeah, I think one thing that connects into is then also their kind of plan on what to do, whether to escape or whether to actually destroy Hydra too. And I think it's like, you know, definitely May and Ward's insistence on actually burning down Hydra and taking down Hydra, because then they don't know. I think neither May nor Ward actually know the truth. Ward doesn't really believe in. He was hoping, and I think, you know, he was even hoping that Skye would be the one to actually, that Daisy would be the one to actually reassure him or to actually tell him that, you know, obviously it's not true that she's a part of this world. But then even she tells him, like, oh well, so Simmons informed you that I'm not from this world and that, you know, I actually have like another world to get back to and everything. So he's still, I think he's just about now coming to terms with that kind of truth. And then May so far, she only believes in actually fighting for the right side. She only would she saw someone who was meant to be her enemy sacrificing his own life to save her and countless others. So then because of that, she's then, you know, switched sails and she's actually fighting for what she believes to be more of the right side. But then she's completely unaware of this whole other world out there that she belongs in and all that kind of jazz. So then for her and Ward, is the same thing, that, you know, like taking down Hydra and everything. But then with Daisy knowing that this isn't the real world and then that this isn't the real Hydra, she doesn't really see the point in actually sticking around and actually spending time taking down taking down a fake embodiment of a real life organization. Because then in the real world, Hydra has already been tackled. In the real world, Hydra has already been kind of cut off and replaced with the head and everything. So you know, Hydra's already been completely demolished in the real world thanks to Gideon Malik's intel for S.H.I.E.L.D. and everything. So with this, it's like, you know, taking down an organization that doesn't really need to be taken down. But I think even her saying, like, even her, like, specifying in the long run, this kind of battle doesn't matter. They just need to get her. They just need to get back to the real world and then actually shut down the framework behind them so that nothing can come and actually follow them through that kind of gateway. So then, but I think given that both Ada and Ada slash Ophelia and Dr. Fitz's plans are to bring Hydra through into the through the looking glass and through the framework and into the real world, I think because of that, taking down Hydra might just be worth it. So that way, even if you do make it to the real world, but then you can't really shut down the framework in time, that then leaves the enemy with ample time to figure out their own escape route and actually come through of their own accord too. So I think actually, like, in that sense, looking at it in that sense, I feel like taking down Hydra one last time before going through the looking glass would be that much more kind of beneficial and that much more kind of satisfactory too. So just kind of cutting down all routes where you can find them so that you don't actually end up sprouting more fucking Venus fly traps in the form of Hydra. So I guess we'll see if they actually do manage to actually, I think on the one hand I can see them doing it, but I think it's just like whether or not they will go forward with it, or whether or not they'll go forward with it, or whether or not they'll actually just kind of jump ahead and actually try and get back home as quickly as they can to try and shut down the framework and shut down Ada as well, or what's going to happen. But I guess we'll see. I guess we shall see. But yeah, that is pretty much it. That is pretty much all I've picked up from this episode. So it was a great re-entry into the show. So I can't wait to see how these last few episodes progress and how this kind of arc and this season ends and how things actually go out from here. But it's going to be a bang. I can already sense that kind of whopper of a finale. I can already sense the whopper of a finale coming from a mile away, because there is no way you do all of this in one season and you don't end on like an absolute banger of an episode. So very, very anxious and eager to get to that point. But so far the story is going great. So very eager to see how things progress from here and how S.H.I.E.L.D. actually rebuilds their resistance and actually goes up against Hydra one last time. But yeah, that is pretty much all I picked up from this. So yeah, that was Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Season 4, Episode 19. So as always, thank you guys so much for being here and for watching this video. If you guys enjoyed it, then salt and burn that like button. Comment on what you thought of the episode and what you think is coming up next time on Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Once again, the full-length reaction will be available over on Patreon, so you can go check that over there. And yeah, that is it. So, I will see you next time.